Hello, everybody. Scott Golden here with the Wrestling Challenge YouTube review series. This is the 1988 November 12th edition. A couple of weeks before the Survivor Series. Of course, Survivor Series is still a Thanksgiving night tradition at this particular juncture. And without a doubt, that's back when Survivor Series still meant something. I think it stopped meaning something probably by around maybe 98, 99, 2000, something like that. But certainly for the first, at least through the mid-90s, that show still meant something to the average fan. We open up with the Blue Blazer, of course, Owen Hart under the mask. Barry Horowitz, his first opponent. Blazer comes in known as the Blue Angel in July. There are a couple of matches showing him as such. Barry Horowitz, of course, a regular enhancement talent. Ken Patera, originally, at this point, a couple of weeks before the Survivor Series, was meant to be on the Ultimate Warrior Survivor Series team, but it is the Blue Blazer that replaces Patera, who I think leaves the promotion around the same time or has an injury. Don't really know the whole deal behind that, but certainly, you know, 33 years ago is when the show takes place. Anyway, really basic stuff, arm bars and hammer locks by Horowitz. Horowitz tries to do everything he can, drops the leg across the shot there by Horowitz. Horowitz rolls up and inside cradle, and ultimately, doesn't get what he wants on that. Horowitz actually takes the majority to his opponent, and it is Owen Hart who finally gets a head scissors takedown, kind of awkward looking, but then manages a belly-to-belly suplex, followed by a top rope splash, which for the time is a big deal. The multi-person tag team match, Slick and Jimmy Hart out with the Russo brothers, the Conquistadors, the Bolsheviks, the Powers of Pain, Brainbusters, of course, new to the area, and all the managers kind of working together to get the heel tag teams ready for, it's a 10-on-10 team match, something like that. Pretty major thing at that time period to see that many tag teams. And so many Hall of Famers, so many really good talents. Outlaw Ron Bass, who isn't here very long, is here now and manages to, he's getting ready to kind of blow off his feud with Brutus the Barber. Beefcake had cut up his rope, and this is a California version of things. Punch kick, very basic stuff. Actually, a kind of modified go behind, almost like a pedigree by Bass. Ugly looking move for a finish. And Bass uses that bullwhip rope to hang his opponent over the top rope. Not a good thing. And couldn't get away with doing that today, but did it back then. Tito Santana and Iron Mike Sharp actually have a competitive match here in 1988. Rare, because you wouldn't see, well, actually, if you're watching AEW, you probably would see a competitive enhancement match these days. Sharp shows a little bit of power. Santana shows speed. Of course, Rick Martel been eliminated from action, actually went home to take care of his ailing wife, who I believe had cancer at this time, right after WrestleMania 4, so that's April. He doesn't come back for a full year, coming back in April of 89. At this point, Santana's kind of lost, and it's sad because Santana had been a major force in the WWF for about 4 years before this, and so kind of getting lost in the shuffle here. Punch kick, basic stuff by Santana. Santana's still a big-time babyface. Atomic drop for his trouble gets him where he wants to be. But ultimately, you know, ducks a clothesline, hit the flying forearm that he's so well known for. And that is that. And Santana gets a victory there. We go to the event center. Hogan and Boss Man are going to main event. I believe it's the 15th of November, so in a few days from the airing of this program. In San Francisco, basically Boss Man says he's going to take the man out. Hacksaw Duggan says he's sick of seeing the American flag disrespected, Heenan and others, not to do that. And he's certainly aggravated by that fact, is Duggan. Then we move to a very brief, although impactful, enhancement talent match as the African Dream Akeem against David Stottlemyre. Obviously, one-sided affair there. Akeem getting a main event push, coming back with the new gimmick after doing the one-man gang thing for about a year, maybe a little bit less, in the World Wrestling Federation, comes back as the America or the African Dream Akeem, of course, making fun of Dusty Rhodes, the American Dream, over in Crockett Land. And so, punch, kick, basic stuff, clothesline, and a front falling suplex by Akeem is the way he gets a victory, probably less than 2 minutes in total there. Doesn't really need a lot when you're that size, probably legit 350, 400 pounds. It's not the same as today's larger athletes who are doing flip-flops, flies, cross bodies, and all that stuff. It's fun to watch for a little while, but at the same time, a little goofy from time to time. Hulk Hogan says he doesn't know how he's going to meter out the punishment to the big boss man at the Cow Palace in California in a couple of days, so there's some wonder there. Hogan is the only main promo in that nature of things. DiBiase against Mario Mancini. Ted DiBiase, Million Dollar Man, kind of leading the main event team at the Survivor Series in a couple of weeks here. But still has not debuted the Million Dollar Belt. I think that's in February or March of 1989. Of course, many can have conjecture to the fact that he was supposed to win the World Championship at WrestleMania 4, and that got bungled and botched. Who knows what the truth is with that? DiBiase obviously does a lot of basic moves here. Doesn't do a heck of a lot, doesn't need to. Obviously, the idea is to get him over, and he does. Back elbows, punches, kicks, and finally the power slam followed by or actually a clothesline followed by the Million Dollar Dream. Of course, some people may know that as the Cobra Clutch if you were around for the Sergeant Slaughter days. Same basic maneuver anyway. In any event, kind of a roll up, go behind kind of deal there. And that's kind of there. They do I guess the report, the special report, Andre the Giant being laid out on Saturday night's main event, October, with the Jake Roberts Snake and the Fear of Snakes deal. And obviously, Ted DiBiase putting the $100 bills down the throat of Mario Mancini post-match. Survivor Series report, getting everything ready, and Rude Bravo, Andre the Giant, and so many other people going to face the Warriors team. Kind of that's a big deal. And the Million Dollar Man's team getting ready to eliminate Hulk Hogan. Boss Man and Hogan seem to be the main focus of that. Of course, that leads to the Mega Powers in their continuing unfolding. Because this is the last, second to last pay-per-view before they explode. And then we go to the main event. During sweeps weeks and sweeps month, which I believe were May and November, we get a main match or two. I did miss a highlight film here in the middle. There's about 2 minutes, 2.5 minutes, something like that, really basic stuff, of the title switch for the Women's Championship, sensational Sherry Rockin' Robin from Paris, France, even with French commentary. Robin hits a second rope bulldog, gets a victory in the process there. I miss it because they did not show the full match. I don't even know if the full match exists on tape. Maybe they showed it on primetime. I know when Moolah and Sherry had their match in 1987, that was there. Bret Hart and Greg the Hammer Valentine, who have been feuding a little bit, and that actually runs through the Hart Foundation, and Valentine and Honky Tonk Man runs twice, once in 1990, once in 1989. The 89 version does culminate at a short, less than 5 minute match at WrestleMania 5. The Rougeau brothers calling for distraction on the outside of the ring. Rougeau brothers' contracts have been purchased or the Hart Foundation contracts have been basically sold or null and voided to take on the Rougeaus by Jimmy Hart. Rougeaus trying to distract Hart on the outside, and Hart with some punches, some kicks. Valentine hits an elbow to the top of the head. Hart ducks the head too quickly. Boom, 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 there we go. And a back suplex by Greg Valentine for his trouble there. The drop of the elbow across the spine, and the Rougeaus even have Jimmy Hart's megaphone, which is weird to see Jimmy without his megaphone, obviously. But figure four attempted by Greg Valentine. Hart kicks him off. Weak kickoff, actually. When you look back at some of the lack of snugness in matches in the 80s versus what we've come to know now with the inversion of MMA, you know, 30 years later, it's a big deal. Hart kicked, Valentine kicked off again with the attempted figure four. Jim Neidhart rushes down to aid his partner. That's that. Meanwhile, Valentine saves Jimmy Hart on the outside because the anvil grabs a hold of him. Valentine sends Neidhart into the steel posts. This is before the January of 89 deal, where in fact they do the use of the guitar, the Honky Tonk Man, to take out, I believe it was Bret Hart from behind. Rougeaus brothers make their way down while the match is actually thrown out. Rougeaus jump Bret Hart with the megaphone from behind. They Greg Valentine locks in the figure four hold, holds on after Hart's been injured, and the announcers basically imply that it could be a more permanent injury. There is a hype promo, two hype promos. One for a match, actually both are for matches in San Francisco at the Cal Palace in a couple of days. One by Ron Bass in his match in Quest against Brutus the Barber Beefcake. Basically says he's going to get even with Beefcake for cutting his whip. And then Jake Roberts and Rick Rude with Cheryl Roberts, Jake's wife. Basically, they're going to do Hold versus Hold, Rude Awakening versus DDT. Jake is with an awesome promo here, basically saying he's going to get even with Rude once and for all. You don't dishonor his wife. And again, there we go. We close with, again, kind of a rundown of the matches. Bravo and Duggan, Demolition and the Rockers for the Tag Team Championship. Beefcake and Ron Bass. All this on the 15th on a Tuesday night at the Cow Palace. DDT versus Rude Awakening, and then of course closing out with Hulk Hogan and the Big Boss Man. That's the end of this particular broadcast, but we'll be back with more right after this.